Why, where tonight we've gone rogue and we'll be ripping up the rule book in the company of this rowdy, rough-hewn rabble, a right ruffian, Jack Carroll. Ruskaya Ravunitsa, Olga Koch. Reckless reprobate, Bill Bailey. And a ruddy rapscallion, Alan Davis. Their ringtones relate to some right rascals of rare renown. Olga's got a Russian. There we go. Jack's got a robber. They see the great train robbery, he was the mastermind. I'm enjoying these ones. Bill's got a Robert. And Alan goes. Rosie and Jim, Rosie and Jim. I mean, that's just creepy, isn't it? Okay. Right, here are some words from the reign of Elizabeth I. What do you think that they mean?
Well, number two is Bill.
Top trickster. How dare you?
Hedge Priest sounds like a 70s rock band, doesn't it?
I like the idea of a hedge priest.
Yeah.
Just jumps out. Want a bit of absolution? Bit of absolution? Do you want a bit of absolution? And cider. Cider, absolution.
You're not far off, actually.
Really?
Weirdly, I know. It's quite close to the truth. Any idea, Olga, all those words?
Oh, I've seen all of them on Grindr.
Really? Yes.
Which one is Grindr, darling? Is that
the gay one?
Oh, right. I don't know. It's a dating app.
It's a dating.
Dating's a loose term.
Dating. Really?
Yes, I don't think dating.
Oh, really?
I don't think it's like, would you like to go take a turn around the park?
Yes.
No. Are you saying they are kind of wrong-uns?
Yes.
Are they rascals?
It's a collective of Tudor rogues, is the thing. So they were recorded by a marvellous man called Robert Greene. He wrote a book called A Notable Discovery of Cousinage.
Ooh.
Yes, and it kicked off an absolute craze of people having guides to beggars and other sort of vagabonds. It became known as rogue literature. And we don't really know why it was called cousinage, but cousin seemed to be a word for a wrong'un.
A rascal. So somebody's trying to elicit money from you under false pretences.
It's a con man.
A con man.
Yeah, so let's go back to the list and have a quick look. Now, you mentioned hedge priest. So medieval priests were paid by tithes, but supposing you couldn't afford to pay the priest, this would be an itinerant preacher who was willing to do the ceremonies that you might want, was willing to marry you, was willing to bury you. What I like is that they reinterpreted the vow, till death us do part, and a couple could separate if they just stood over a dead animal in the road.
Step lightly over this badger and all will be well.
Yeah, exactly that.
I think if I was a trickster, though, I'd pick a more subtle name than counterfeit crank.
What do you think a counterfeit crank might do?
Well, a crank starts the engine, doesn't it?
No,
they
didn't
have they didn't have engines, so I'm going to... Yeah, no engines, so no, not that.
Crank. Well, crank, like, cranky, so he's, like, doing crimes, but he's not happy about it.
Well, he certainly is not happy in his look, because...
A little bit crazy.
Yeah, so
a crazy counterfeiter. A pretend crank.
It's a pretend crank, so it's somebody who pretends that they've got something wrong with them.
Oh, right.
There was a particular one called a clapper dudgeon, and they used to, it's very unpleasant, create superficial wounds by rubbing a mix of lime and soda and iron rust, and it caused sort of blisters and sores. Oof. And then you would trick people. The other way of tricking them, of course, was to cut the festering arm or leg off a corpse, you know, perhaps from a handy gibbet.
Yes.
And then pretend it was yours.
Oh, just sort of have it stuck to your
arm. Well, you could lie on the ground with a blanket with and a stick the nasty...
And to what end, Sandy, would you
to,
do...
To get people to give you money.
Get money.
Feel sorry for
you. And you're dying at one limb at a time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you'd have to remember to not just pick it up with your good hand as well.
Yeah.
Right? Oh, thanks very much.
Right. Can you put it right into the hand? What else? Come on, Jack, you pick one.
Well, nips and foists sound like something a plumber would overcharge you to fix.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, that's it, nips and foists, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, ooh, that's going to set you back a bit. All right,
nips. £40 a nip, isn't it, really?
Nips and foists, names for pickpockets. So a nip used a knife to cut open a purse and catch the contents, and a foist dips their hand into them.
Surely that's a cut purse.
Is another name for it. In fact, there's a very famous play called Mole Cut Purse. Olga, you pick one. What have we got left? Crossbiter. Do you want to have that one?
A crossbiter. I mean, who would, like, eat like a vampire?
It's a vampire. Somebody pretending to be a vampire.
Yeah, they hate Jesus. they're like, oh, let's get rid of this.
It was a common con. People who pretended to be vampires and hate Jesus. No, so it's a rogue, obviously,
yes.
Who poses as a prostitute's drunken husband. Burst into the room. What are you doing?
Oh no, it's the prostitute.
Yeah,
the sex worker's husband. Sorry.
We're due to times, darling. Prostitute's absolutely fine. And the last one is Beartop Trickster.
Beartop Trickster.
Someone without a hat.
Someone who does some sort of like a
nipple lap.
Nipple. What are you doing?
I mean, somebody with their top off.
Yes.
Doing tricks.
With juggling.
Juggling.
No.
It's like, look here, and then his partner goes and does some bad stuff.
Yes, it is exactly right. Yes. Yeah. Yes, so a woman would flash a bare top. And then possibly lure a man into a house, and then the gang of men would do robbing of him.
Really?
Yes.
But how long is that going to bamboozle a man, though? I mean, how much bamboozlement is there in? An hour? Just keep going. That's great. Or just a couple of? I mean, ten seconds.
I think you'd be surprised how easy some men are, darling.
What do you mean?
Moving on. A good criminal needs to work on their getaway, so I want you guys to reinvent the run. What ideas could you suggest to make life easier for runners?
Well, as someone with cerebral palsy...
Yes, darling.
I have spent a lot of time thinking about how I would rework my running style, and I think it goes beyond a simple matter of technique, to be honest.
Does
I think
it?
There's something deeper at work.
Yes,
there.
Something more philosophical.
Yeah.
But has anybody got any thoughts about it? We know how you run normally. Can anybody sort of mime how you run normally?
You run...
Wow. It's like you've turned into a cartoon.
What?
Do you run?
Alan, you're doing it all.
I mean, there is no problem a Russian athlete hasn't tried to solve with steroids. So. Yeah.
That's cool. I won the 400 metres back running. I run backwards faster than I can run forward.
This is an event he's staged entirely alone.
Would you like to show us?
All right. Yes.
Can you do it down there?
Yes,
can you
I will.
In the front.
Okay.
There?
Hang on. Right. So this is me running normally forwards in the traditional style.
Phil, right. That's surprisingly camp.
Surprisingly camp.
So there was a study done at Harvard University, a man called Andrew Yegian, and what he found was that walking with completely straight arms was more efficient than walking...
What, like this?
This. Yes.
It looks like I've got some live animals in my pocket.
Yeah, try running with straight arms.
Running with straight arms.
Yes.
All right. Okay.
Try that. Yeah.
Here we go.
Yeah.
I feel I've done. There's a slight penguin vibe. I'll do the penguin going round the corner gag. You'll love this.
That's marvellous. So this study, which was in 2019, what he discovered is that running with straight arms instead of them bent makes no difference, actually, to the speed or the efficiency. So they gave everybody oxygen masks and asked them to walk and run on treadmills trying these things, because obviously if you use more energy, you're going to need more oxygen.
Yes.
Walking with straight arms, actually more efficient, uses 11% less oxygen than walking with bent arms. And when it came to running, it made no difference, really, in terms of oxygen consumption. So the truth is, we don't really know why we run with bent arms. It's just that everybody seems to think it's harder to run with straight arms. It's possibly just it feels like your head is more stable. Possibly you get less fatigued because your shoulders are moving. They are constantly trying to find new ways of running. So Alphabet / Google's AI company, DeepMind,
yes.
They tried to challenge the computer to see if it could learn a different way of running. And they used sort of virtual rewards and punishments to get the computer to see if there was a better way of moving. I have to say, it's very bizarre. Yeah. And if this was how you run, well, I think I would have fallen over immediately, but this is... this is the computer reckoned. It's from...
In the middle of... It's fallen over again!
That well, is... the idea... the idea was that you're training the computer and every time it fails, it has to start again. Anyway, the video looks very odd, but it is apparently the computer trying to find the most efficient way of moving. Right. Since we're giving everybody the runaround, here is a question for you. How did Olga use a pigeon to wreak her revenge? Hmm. Do you know
me?
This? Yes. Well, not you, but a namesake.
Oh.
I have an idea.
Okay.
The only other Olga I'm competing with on Google search, which I check every day, is the woman who brought Christianity to Russia.
Okay. And what can you tell me about her?
I know how her husband was killed, and that wasn't pretty.
Go on then.
So they took two birch trees and they bent them, and then they tied his legs to each tree, and then they let the trees go.
Yeah, that is
so
correct.
So sorry.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
He was attached.
Yeah.
To both.
I mean, not for long.
No.
No.
So he was rent asunder.
Yes. By a neighbouring tribe, the Drevlians, and God. She was terribly unhappy. So she decided to get revenge.
Terrible.
So this is the Russian saint Olga. She came from the city of... Is it P-S-K-O-V?
Skov.
Skov.
That's too many consonants.
It is, isn't it? Yeah, yeah. Anyway, she decided to get her revenge. So what she did was she laid siege to the capital of the Drevlian people, Iskorosten. Iskorosten. Shall I just say it quickly?
Oh, just go for it.
Yeah, Iskorosten. totally nailed it, which is in, now in the Ukraine. So what she did, she laid siege to the town and she said she would only accept surrender in the form of a tribute of a pigeon and some sparrows from every single household. So everybody thought, that's not too bad. So the Drevlians, they all sent these birds out. And she ordered a piece of sulphur to be tied to each bird's leg and ignited, and the birds were released. They all flew home and burnt the city to the ground in moments.
Good Lord.
I know, as a bird lover, you're horrified.
I'm horrified by that.
I know.
And fascinated at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah. They obviously were brave modern-day pigeons, otherwise they'd have gone, no, I'm not doing that, give me some chips.
Yeah,
yeah. I've seen a few London pigeons who would have just run that off. Yeah.
Yeah,
sulfur, I'll just run that off.
Yeah, that's all right.
Bit of sulfur, innit? Yeah. I'll dip it in Trafalgar Square fountain, here we go. Right, OK, where's that Nando's?
One group that pigeons are best to avoid are hairdressers. This is a bizarre thing. So they did another study at the University of Lyon. Pigeons who live near hairdressers have fewer toes.
Huh?
I know! It's probably the only thing you'll remember when you go home.
Hold on.
Yes.
What is that? So pigeons landing on people's heads while they're having their hair cut. Something off the pigeons? Yes, please, just the toes.
No, it's that they're apparently they get them entangled in human hair that has been incorrectly disposed of, and it causes them
Good Lord.
To lose toes.
And where was this again that we mustn't go?
Hairdressers.
Oh, yes, you're
okay. I think you're fine.
I'm fine.
Yeah. remaining in Russia, what's the most powerful drink in history?
I'm gonna go, I'm gonna just.
Yes!
Vodka.
I love vodka, actually. Do you like...
I like vodka because it says so much about Russian people. Like, Russian people bit into a raw potato and we really were like, this is amazing, but can we make it liquid and ruin our lives?
So, the most powerful drink in history is not vodka, it is... Pepsi. So, for a very brief time in 1990, the sixth largest military fleet in the world was owned and commanded by Pepsi. I know. So, 1972, Pepsi executive, there he is, Donald Kendall, he successfully negotiated an entire monopoly of cola in the Soviet Union. So, Coca-Cola were out and it was only going to be Pepsi.
Is now, he trying to get that can off his face?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, white eyebrows again.
But So the ruble wasn't worth very much money internationally at the time, and anyway, the Kremlin forbid the foreign sale of rubles. So a deal was struck initially where Pepsi-Cola syrup was swapped for mountains of Soviet vodka. That deal lasted until 1990, when Pepsi decided that vodka was not enough payment. So Russia agreed a $3 billion deal that everything would be paid in Soviet warships.
Mm. The official units in Russia are mountains of vodka and warships.
And warships, yes. They got 17 submarines, a frigate, a cruiser and a destroyer for their drink, and they briefly became the sixth most powerful navy in the entire world.
And then eBayed the lot.
Yeah. They sold it to a Swedish company for scrap. There's a little Swede going, hello, yes, scrap merchant. How many? 17 submarines. Just a moment.
Yeah. We can do this.
But apparently it's a thing in Russia. So they once offered New Zealand MiG fighter jets and tanks and a nuclear submarine to wipe out $100 million debt for dairy imports.
Oh, I'm not surprised at
You're
all.
You're not? No.
They sold me off.
That's a complaint. You're right.
I mean, also, Coca-Cola must be shitting themselves. Just go.
They've got that silly truck that goes around.
Yeah.
Yeah. Pepsi have got a nuke.
You know what vodka means, literally? It has a literal meaning.
Yeah. Small water?
Yes, yeah, yeah, little water. What is water?
Voda.
Voda, and so vodka is just like slightly harder. Am I right that the Russians sometimes will keep some in the house, like bathroom vodka, like for just kind of a cleaning and... Is that
I mean,
true?
That's what my mom used to say. It's for cleaning, Olga.
Wonderful, this picture is. It's like one of my old Christmases when I was a kid. Some of my West Country relatives.
This is a mildly offensive picture. This is, this is the West's idea of Russia.
I'd say it's offensive, but that's literally my dad.
Okay. But I like their attitude, because it wasn't until January the 1st in 2013 that beer was classified as an alcoholic beverage.
Really?
No. Anything under 10% alcohol was characterised...
Was baby formula?
..was a foodstuff. the strongest beer ever made, according to the Guinness World Records, was a beer called the End of History. It was made by the Scottish company Brewdog. It was 55% alcohol. So if you think vodka mostly is 40%.
What the hell?
When you've had a pint of that, this is what you see.
This is what you see.
They sent 10...
This is like some of my lockdown dreams.
They sent 10 of their investors a bottle of this particular beer mounted inside a taxidermy roadkill squirrel.
That someone got divorced over.
I think, yes.
It's not drunk God. As a beer, though, is it? It's drunk in a shot glass.
It says it should be drunk in small serving.
Yeah.
Is entirely correct.
I bet this is in the inside locker of every RSPCA warden. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you care for him on the outside, inside. There you go. Turn him into a bottle, that's what I say. Bloody vermin! You're bloody vermin, that's what you are! You can hope for, you miserable little git. Turn him into an optic, that's what I say.
All the taxidermy ideas.
Yeah.
All the legs turned into
somebody's trying to sell me a theremin made out of a badger. All right?
A badger.
You know a badger?
I know what a badger is. I didn't know what the first word was.
A theremin. You know that it was invented by the Russian radio engineer, Leon Theremin, in 1918.
What is it?
It's a thing that goes, woo!
It's like a pole, and when you go near it, it senses you and makes a noise.
Yeah.
OK.
He was trying to invent an alarm, a motion sensor, and he inadvertently invented this instrument, which, you know, as you go closer, it goes, woo! And then he sort of calibrated it into an instrument, Leon Theremin.
And there's one shaped like a badger.
Well, somebody... People give me these things. People give me all kinds of strange things.
We're never going to sell this. Hang on.
I've been given strange things, but it usually results in penicillin.
Well...
We know you love the weasel ukulele.
I love the weasel ukulele. That's giving me ideas. No. Somebody knitted me a praying mantis once. That was the strangest thing. But no, the theremin. The theremin was a stuffed badger on a pole, and you moved your hand closer, it went, was one of the most disturbing things I've ever seen. It just reminded me of it there.
I totally want a beaver that does that. Do you know what
we have a beaver. Calm down. Just behave yourself.
I want a beaver that does that.
I want a beaver that does that.
All right. You can't help it. You'll have to wear earplugs.
I mean, that sort of sound is directly out of a Carry On film as well. That thing.
Be careful if you're ever doing a deal in Russia, as they might add shipping. Come on. Now, what is the most extreme way anyone's ever avoided having sex?
Any kind of self-mutilation involved?
You're saying you take one testicle and strap it to one sapling, and then you take one testicle and you strap it to another sapling, and bang!
We're talking about creatures, rather than
animals. Okay, so something that animals do to prevent having
sex. Avoid, yeah. So we are in the world of dragonflies. I don't know if any of you have noticed, there's been a huge influx of dragonflies in the UK this last year.
Is that a 69?
That...
yeah, not strictly.
It's quite difficult.
It's quite a high number.
Yeah. It's quite hard to work out who's doing
heart,
what to who. There.
It's a beautiful heart.
Yeah, it's...
One of them saying, get off me, you bastard.
Yeah.
Well, that is in fact correct, because that is one of the things that the female dragonfly will do. So, this is a study by a man called Rasim Khalifa, a zoologist from the University of Zurich. So, female dragonflies, the ones that are known as the common hawker, pretend to be dead while being pursued by a male in order to avoid amorous attention.
Well, this is something that I've seen frequently.
It's called thanatosis. It's Greek for putting to death, and it is a way of avoiding sex, is to pretend...
to be dead.
..that you are dead, yeah.
So, I knew there was a word for it. I knew it.
So what usually happens is, after mating, most male dragonflies will guard their partner, but this particular species, which is known as the Ashna Junkia, they just fly off and they allow the female to be harassed by other males. But if another male tries to mate with her at that point, as she's had sex already, her reproductive tract might be damaged, or she could even be drowned by an aggressive male because they spend a lot of time on the water. And so to avoid this, they go into the undergrowth and lie motionless on their backs, and the amorous male gives up and goes away. I know. That is an extraordinary picture, isn't it?
It is. It's beautiful, actually.
Yeah.
It's stunning.
It is astonishing, the whole insect world. Years ago, we talked about a male arachnid who gives a gift to a female to allow him to mate with her, but the gift is often fake, and she doesn't realise until he's had his way and scarpered.
The bear-top prankster.
The bear-top prankster. Well, there is a spider species called the Pisaura mirabilis, and these males go one even further. The male initiates sex by presenting the larger female, okay, with a tasty snack.
Yes.
Like, I don't know, would it be a fly? Maybe it would be a tasty snack.
Of course.
And while she distractedly tucks into it, he begins copulation. And then if she tries to make off with the gift, he plays dead and holds on to the present so that she has to drag him with it. And, I know, and then when she stops, he springs back to life and has another go at it.
I've seen a version of that a very late night near a bus stop with a kebab. Come back, I'll bloody love you.
Now we venture into the roguish round that's really good for nothing, general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. Why is the River Thames brown?
Is it because of silt?
Absolutely right. tidal currents. So it's nothing to do with pollution, which you might think. It's silt and sand. There was a time when a lot of waste flowed directly into the Thames. In fact, in 1957, the Natural History Museum declared the Thames was biologically dead, and it had become a sort of foul-smelling drain. Mm. But a new modern system of sewage was put in the 1960s, and today it's said to be one of the cleanest rivers in the world. 138 seal pups in counted in 2018.
You wouldn't want to drink a cup of it, though, would you?
You wouldn't want to drink a cup of it. But I had to do some filming, and I was standing on the very top of the O2, which we can see there. I took a photograph. There was a seal. I mean, it's not a very good photograph because it was miles and miles away. But I could see about six seals from where I was at the top of the O2.
There's a colony of seals living at Teddington Lock.
Is there?
Yes. There's porpoise, dolphin and whale I've seen in the Thames when I've been paddleboarding.
I mean, that's not to say there isn't shed loads of rubbish in the Thames.
Corpses.
They reckon about a corpse a week in the Thames.
Oh,
we're just trying to avoid sex.
I know. The Port of London Authority removes about 200 tonnes of rubbish from the river every year. In just one day in 2019, the PLA removed 70 tangled trolleys that were spotted clumped together at low tide. I mean, oof, look at that. I know.
That's beautiful.
And 60% of the rubbish is single-use plastic. So,
yes.
You know. Please use a reusable bottle. OK. The colour of the Thames is mostly down to silt. There is still some pollution in there, but mentioning that just muddies the water. Right. what is this wave called?
Big.
Freak. It's a freak wave.
It's not a tidal wave.
A massive wave. Massive wave. Storm freak. Wave. Wall
look
of
out.
Water.
A lookout. A buttock clench. A trouser filler.
A surfer drowner.
An absolute boat bloody shitstormer. A rascally rogue.
A rogue wave.
Oh, a rogue wave.
A rogue
oh, what
wave.
You say.
So tidal waves occur in shallow water, right?
Yes.
They're caused by gravitational interactions between the sun and the moon and the earth. Tsunamis are giant waves caused by
tectonic shifts.
Yeah, so undersea earthquakes and volcanic eruptions and so on. The thing here, this is a rogue wave. They are sometimes called freak waves. They are mountainous swells.
We just don't know why. Is it one of those?
We don't really know why. What defines them? They have to be twice the height of more than
Richard
a third
Osborne.
Of the waves in the air.
Oh.
And they appear really suddenly. I mean, they're unbelievably dangerous for shipping. And for centuries, people thought it was an exaggeration by sailors that no such thing really existed. Then on New Year's Day in 1995, an enormous wave smashed into the Draupner oil platform, which is just off the coast of Norway. And it was recorded at an astonishing 85 feet from trough to peak. And it was the standard assumption was that these waves maybe happened once every 10,000 years or something.
Did it knock it over? Were they all
no, right? No, no, everybody was absolutely fine, yeah. But they analysed about 30,000 satellite images over a three-week period in 2003 and they discovered 10 waves around the world that had reached that height. So it is not quite as freaky as you thought. And nobody knows how they're created. According to Peter Chelliner of the National Oceanographic Centre in Southampton, people have been working actively on this for the past 50 years at least. We don't even have the start of a theory.
Oh. I'm just imagining a lot of scientists on surfboards going, oh, shit. Yeah.
This is one. Definitely one.
It reminds me of one of those Japanese prints, you know, those sort of prints of them.
Beautiful.
And that's my phone case, actually, is that painting, that Japanese painting.
Is it really?
The wave, yeah, yeah. So that's consumerism for you.
Yeah. Right there.
Yeah.
It turns out rogue waves aren't tall stories, but are stories tall. All of which brings us to the final scores. In fourth place, the villain of tonight's piece, with minus 29, is Alan. In third place, with minus 8, it's Bill. Yay. In second place, with minus 6, it's Olga. Sneaking into first place, an absolutely quizzy rascal with 4 plus points, it's Jack. It only remains for me to thank Olga and Bill and Jack and Alan, and I leave you with this impish tip from Steve Martin. For sincere advice and the correct time, call any number at random at 3 a.m.